Well, it looks like the number of participants has leveled off, so hopefully that's enough time. So I'm very happy to welcome Professor Rishtinkin. Of course, he's one of the preeminent scholars of mathematical physics, and most of you probably know his work in quantum groups and representation theory in connection with topological elements of knots and all that great stuff. And I'm very happy to hear him talk about superintegrable systems, an area close to my heart. So thank you very much for joining us, and take it away.
Well, thank you for the flattering introduction. I'll be talking about the class of integrable systems with the name superintegrable systems. And these are classical integrable systems which have natural quantum counterparts. And as you can see, that it's a very natural class. Refining the Liouville integrability. So here's the plan. First, I'll give the definition of superintegrable systems, then examples, and then superintegrable systems on moduli spaces of G-flat connections on a surface. So this all is based on this last part is based on joint work with Semyon Artamonov, and then some of the examples are closely related to the ongoing work with Jasper Stokman. Okay, so what is a superintegrable system? First, about the name. The name is catchy, but it doesn't really represent the meaning of these systems. It's more like emotional. It's superintegrable in the sense that it's so integrable that it's super. So kind of most scientific names, I think, degenerate integrability or non-commutative integrability. But somehow this name got abandoned, and that's what survived. So I'll call them superintegrable systems. So first examples go back to the work of Pauli, and I forgot Fock. And then the next series of examples came up with the work of Smorodinsky, Winternitz, and others. Then Nikhoroshev, he was a student of Arnold. He developed some kind of, he formulated these systems in a way that's clearly extending the Liouville integrability. And then Mishenko, Fomenko, and others gave many examples related to Lie groups, Lie algebras. So that's about the name. And now the substance. So suppose we have a symplectic manifold. As usual, the phase space for a classical integrable system. So smooth functions on M, usually analytic functions on M, these are the classical observables. And typically, to define the dynamics, Hamiltonian dynamics, we fix a function that's the Hamiltonian of the system. And then there is a very important notion, the notion of the centralizer of the Hamiltonian in our Poisson algebra. So our symplectic manifold, symplectic structure on M gives the Poisson brackets on functions, and the centralizer of H is a Poisson subalgebra in A of functions which Poisson commute with H. And typically, if you just choose randomly the Hamiltonian, the centralizer will be generated by H itself, nothing else. So every extra function that Poisson commutes with the Hamiltonian gives you the integral of motion and kind of gives you one step towards complete integrability. So now the definition of superintegrability. The Hamiltonian flow generated by our Hamiltonian is superintegrable if there exists a Poisson subalgebra. In our algebra of observables of rank 2n minus k. So such that, no, this is the mistake. This should be j. So such that maximal independent set in this commutative, I mean, I'm just recalling the definition of the rank, that maximal independent set consists of 2n minus k elements. So, you know, you can think of this, yeah. So then, so that's the first feature. So the system is superintegrable if there is a there is this subalgebra. And second, the Poisson center of J should have rank k. The Poisson center of J, so J now is a Poisson algebra. It's just the all functions, all elements in J, which Poisson commute with everything in J. So the center should have rank K. In other words, it should contain maximum K independent functions, I1, IK, and our Hamiltonian should belong to the center. So that's the definition of a superintegrability of the Hamiltonian dynamics generated by H. So as you can see, there are general structures and particular structures. So the general structure is this subalgebra J of rank 2n minus k, and the center of J of rank k. And then you can choose any Hamiltonian from this central Poisson subalgebra, and it will give a superintegrable dynamics. So it means algebraically, superintegrable dynamics really means the following, that we have the Poisson algebra, algebra of functions on our phase space. In this Poisson algebra, there should be Poisson subalgebra of rank 2n minus k. And the center of this Poisson subalgebra should have rank k. It's very important to have this balance of dimensions. So the J's, they are integrals of motions, conserved quantities of our Hamiltonian dynamics. And these are the Poisson commuting Hamiltonians. So you can see that in these systems, really the dynamical Hamiltonians, there are k independent Hamiltonians that can generate the dynamics. So that's the rank of this Poisson commutative subalgebra. But then there are these non-commutative conserved quantities which do not participate in the dynamics. You can think of this as of them as a symmetry of the system. Geometrically, such superintegrable systems mean the following, that say in algebraic situation, if A is a commutative, is a nice commutative algebra, then you have the notion of the spectrum of this algebra. So in other words, so in terms of symplectic and Poisson geometry, superintegrability means that you have two projections from your symplectic manifold. Projection P1 to a Poisson manifold of dimension 2n minus k, such, and then the fibers of this projection will be k-dimensional isotropic submanifolds in M. And then the second projection is to some k-dimensional manifold such that the fibers, generic fibers, and I should emphasize the word generic, because in interesting cases, there are always special degenerate fibers. So generic fibers are 2n minus 2k dimensional symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold. So this is what superintegrability is. And clearly, if you say that k is equal to m, then the only thing you have is the then P and B coincide, and that's the Liouville integrability. So then Nikhorashev, he formulated and proved this theorem. That's the analog of what we have for Liouville integrability. And it says the following. Just first, let's go back, and I want to say a few more words about this. I'm J1, JK, and here maximal commuting. Ah, it's written. I1, IK. How we should think about these I's and J's in terms of these geometrical pictures? So we can think of J1, J2n minus k as local coordinates on P, and I1, IK, these are local coordinates on B. So we choose local coordinates. Local coordinates means local coordinate functions. And flow lines of these local coordinates on the base, these functions on B, the Poisson commute, they generate affine coordinates phi1, phi k on level surfaces of the integrals. So on these fibers. On these fibers, we have coordinates phi I. These are affine coordinates in the sense that coordinate transformations, they are translations and linear transformations. And it's just the same as in the Liouville theory. It follows immediately from the commutativity of the integrals I1, IK. If you choose different coordinate system, you choose a different system of K commuting integrals, then this is a different coordinate system, and then you have this coordinate transformation. So then the action angle theorem. So it says that in the neighborhood, so we have this projection M to P, and C is in P. So then it goes to B. This is P2, P1, and it also belongs to some fiber P2 inverse B that's possibly a union of connected symplectic leaves in P. So here we have P1 inverse C, the pre-image. That's the possibly disjoint union of connected Liouville tori. So on the tori we have coordinates phi, and on the base we have coordinates ii. So in the vicinity, if it would be just a Liouville integrable system, we would have our symplectic form to be in the Darboux chart. And so this I and phi would be Darboux coordinates for omega. And we would have nothing else but just this kind of Darboux form of omega. But now our symplectic manifold is 2n dimensional. Here we have only 2k variables. So we have the missing 2n minus 2k variables. But now we have a symplectic form on these fibers. So it's a symplectic form on the fibers of P2. And that's the action angle property for this superintegrable systems, that the symplectic form in action angle variables, it has the canonical piece plus the symplectic structure on the fiber of P2, which you can bring to Darboux form. You don't have to, but it's just there. Okay, so then there is another part of the Liouville theorem for the Liouville integrable systems, that each Liouville torus is a product of Rn and some dimensional torus, so that the total dimension is the dimension of the symplectic manifold over 2. So here it's just the same thing. So the dimension of the fiber is k, and every connected component of the fiber is isomorphic to this product. So these are the, I'll still call them Liouville tori. And then finally, if we choose any Hamiltonian from this Poisson commutative Poisson algebra, then the flow lines of such Hamiltonian are linear in angle variables. And so that's the kind of, that's what we want from integrable systems. We want to solve equations of motions. So you can see that coordinates on the fiber, now they move linearly if we succeed to find them, if we succeed to kind of to find the angle variables for this system. And the J coordinates, the coordinates on the intermediate Poisson space, they don't move. These are the integrals of motions. So this is the, so we solve the equations of motions if we can do all this geometry. And of course, the devil is in details. It's the non-trivial part is how exactly compute these coordinates and so on. So then I want to focus on the notion of refinement because, I mean, you may ask the question, say, if you have a Liouville integrable system, is it superintegrable? Or if you have a superintegrable system, is it Liouville integrable? So the answer is that superintegrable system doesn't have to be Liouville integrable. And a Liouville integrable system doesn't have to be superintegrable system. It's sort of partial relation. So, so here is the Liouville part of the story. When k equals n, in this case, we have n-dimensional Liouville tori. And in the Poisson algebra of rank 2n, with non-degenerate Poisson structure, we have the Poisson commutative subalgebra Jn. So in the superintegrable case, we have k-dimensional invariant tori, k is strictly less than n, and we have this structure, the intermediate Poisson subalgebra and the center of this Poisson subalgebra. So we will say that this superintegrable system is a refinement of our Liouville integrable system. If these Poisson subalgebras are related like this, the for the Liouville integrable system, the subalgebra of rank n, it's in between the subalgebra of integrals for the superintegrable system. So they do not Poisson commute. So this is a Poisson commutative. But not necessarily central, and actually it's not central, but not central subalgebra. And J and I's, this is the center, Poisson center of J. So if they are in this relation, then we say that superintegrable system is a refinement of our Liouville integrable system. Let's look at what it means geometrically. So here is a sort of typical structure of the Liouville torus for two-dimensional Liouville torus in a four-dimensional phase space. We know that the dynamics is kind of constrained to the torus because we have two integrals of motions, but we don't know whether the trajectories, they will cover this torus kind of at the end of the day completely, or if they are periodic. That information we don't have, and we need extra piece of information to say whether all trajectories periodic or not. In a superintegrable system, when we have three conserved quantities, but they don't have to be Poisson commutative, our Liouville tori are one dimensional. And if you have a refinement like this, if it exists, then we can say that in the Liouville integrable system, all trajectories are one dimensional. So this is the relation between Liouville integrable systems and superintegrable systems. Just I want to repeat again that you can have superintegrable systems that don't admit this global Poisson commutative subalgebra of rank n, and you can have superintegrable systems. Anyway, so I don't want to repeat myself. So that's the relation. I don't know. Are there any questions about this? Okay. So how much time do I have? I didn't look at the beginning of the talk.
We started about let's call it 5 minutes late. So you've gone 20 minutes. You have about half an hour, but we can be flexible about it.
Okay. Yeah. So it's just that give me a warning, maybe 5 minutes before the deadline.
I will. Absolutely.
Okay. So let me be very slow and in details describe the classical and quantum Kepler system. So classically, it's a Kepler system. In quantum mechanics, it's the hydrogen atom. The phase space is just the cotangent bundle to R3. So it's R3 cross R3 with momentum on the first copy and with coordinates on Q coordinates on the second copy. The symplectic form is the standard dp dq. The Hamiltonian is something that I think everyone from this seminar, you knew it from the middle school, it's from the high school. So it's the Hamiltonian describing kind of gravitational particle in the gravity field generated by infinite mass. So then how many integrals do we have for this system? So obviously, the Hamiltonian is rotationally invariant. So we have momenta. We have components of the momentum tensor. So we have three integrals. But then the beauty of this system is that there is also a so-called Lenz vector, which also its components also Poisson commute with H. It describes another symmetry of this Hamiltonian, kind of hidden symmetry. It's interesting that, in a different form, but the first idea of this Lenz vector, it came from a Swiss mathematician who was the uncle of Euler on mother's line. But I remember by heart the name of this mathematician, but I forgot. So anyway, somehow there is this interesting historical detail here. So altogether we have six functions on a six-dimensional phase space that Poisson commute with our Hamiltonian. So clearly there must be relations. Before we find the relations, these are the Poisson brackets between components of the of these vectors. So this is the usual rotational symmetry, and then this is something that you can easily compute. And as I said, components are integrals of motions, so they are preserved by the Hamiltonian. So, but as we expect, there are relations. There are two relations. And so as a result, we have our algebra of functions on the phase space of rank 6. In this algebra, we have the Poisson subalgebra of rank 5, and the center of this Poisson subalgebra has rank 1. These are the functions of the Hamiltonian. So this rank 5 subalgebra is just the Poisson subalgebra generated by components of the momentum of the Lenz vector of the Hamiltonian modulo these relations. Okay, and again, it's a computation, but it's an easy computation to show that functions of H is exactly the center of the Poisson subalgebra J5. So geometrically, we have these two projections. We have the vibration of our phase space by fibers that project to P5, the this Poisson manifold where M, A, and H are modular relations are coordinates. And then here we have symplectic leaves, which are P inverse of B. And the last piece is just the possible values of H, and that's the whole line. So these are possible values of H. Okay, so it's so-called maximally superintegrable in the sense that all compact trajectories are periodic because it's rank one, because Liouville tori are one-dimensional. And non-compact trajectories are just straight lines. But then let's look at the fibers of P2. So here I called it B because these are the coordinates on B, but the ideal name of course is E. These are the energy, classical energy levels. And this classification is well known. It's just that you know, sometimes you don't pay attention that there is this beautiful thing that's, you know, kind of school, in the school material. So if E is less than zero, so these are the periodic Liouville tori. The fiber is S2 cross S2, and it's a coadjoint orbit in the dual space to the Lie algebra SO4. In the for the there is a special level zero energy. In this case, the fiber P2 is the cotangent bundle to the sphere, to a sphere S2, and you know all these fibers are symplectic manifolds. So here there is a natural symplectic structure. That's the Kirilov constant Poisson structure. The same is here, and it's explicitly here as a symplectic structure on the cotangent bundle. So this is the symplectic leaf of the Lie algebra of three-dimensional motions. And this again is an orbit which is a hyperboloid coadjoint orbit in the dual space to the Lie algebra SO31. And this is something that's known as the hidden SO, hidden Lorentz symmetry in the hydrogen atom. So in the quantum case. So now, okay, so this is the beautiful structure on the Kepler system, which you simply don't see if you don't pay attention to the superintegrability issues. So now let's look at the quantum case. So quantization of functions on our functions on, of PQ naturally are differential operators on R. So this is the quantum algebra of observables. Our quantum Hamiltonian is certainly there. It's a differential operator of the form minus Laplacian plus minus gamma over Q. So here there is some subalgebra generated by components of quantum momentum, quantum Lenz vector, and quantum Hamiltonian. And again, there are some relations. I will not write these relations. I will just I just want to mention something that I learned from learning about quantum superintegrable systems that I should have known in 10th grade, but I didn't. So, so we have this quantum superintegrable system in an obvious sense that here we have the subalgebra of rank 5, whatever it means, and here we have the center of this subalgebra of rank 5, which is commutative algebra of rank 1. So now let's look at the spectrum of our Hamiltonian. And let's just, so it's well known that it has three components that are, that should be distinct, distinguished. The discrete spectrum, the boundary of the discrete spectrum and continuum spectrum and the continuum spectrum. So the energy levels that are negative equals zero and positive energies. So now let's look at the discrete spectrum. It's well known that the spectrum looks like this. The energy levels are some constant h divided by, well, strictly speaking, there should be h squared here. So some constant c divided by n squared. And the eigenspace for this energy level has dimension n squared, which means that it's you can represent it as the tensor product of two spaces. Each of them have dimension n. So the beauty is that the momentum m acts diagonally on these representations as on representations of SO3. And these are the orbitals. And you know, in the chemistry lessons, I was trying to understand this structure of orbitals and it was a pain in the neck. But now it's completely clear. There are two kinds of symmetry. There is a full symmetry on the of the hydrogen atom. That's the action of this subalgebra. It acts irreducibly on this tensor product. But then there is a subalgebra generated by the momentum which acts diagonally. And of course it acts reducibly. You have to take the, you have to decompose the tensor product of irreducible representations into irreducible components. And these are the orbitals. And that's the kind of quantum structure of the discrete spectrum of the hydrogen atom from the point of view of superintegrability. So now let's see what happens as h goes to zero and why the name degenerate integrable systems, we already can see why degenerate integrable systems, the name is quite reasonable here, because you see the spectrum is degenerate here. And it's degenerate in the following way. Consider the semi-classical limit as h goes to zero, but we want to keep the energy levels finite. Let's say we want to have the energy level negative, but fine. That means that we have to set n to infinity in such a way that the product hm is fixed, because that's how the energy levels depend on h bar and n. But now the dimension of the eigenspace is n squared, so it's proportional to h to the minus two. So it means that the dimension of the degeneracy of the eigenvectors in this limit, of the eigenvalues in this limit, they behave as h to the minus half of the dimension of the corresponding symplectic leaf, intermediate symplectic leaf divided by two. That's the dimension of the space of geometric quantization of this symplectic manifold P2 inverse E. And so that's a general kind of feature of semi-classical limit of superintegrable systems, is that there is a difference with Liouville integrable systems. So with Liouville integrable systems, the dimensions of joint eigen subspaces for quantum Hamiltonians are stable as h goes to zero. They don't have to be one. They can be, I don't know, some finite number, but they are stable. They are determined by the intersection of certain Lagrangians. It's just, it's the number of intersection points. So that's the behavior of the eigen subspaces as h goes to zero. Now, in superintegrable systems, you have this intermediate structure, this Poisson submanifold and symplectic leaves and this Poisson submanifold. So the dimension of joint eigen subspaces of the quantum commuting Hamiltonians H1, HK, it is behaving as H to the minus N minus K, which is H to the minus half of the dimension of this symplectic manifold. And that's exactly what you get when you consider, say, compact symplectic manifold, you do the geometric quantization on it. You have sequence of finite dimensional vector spaces, and then you take the limit as H goes to zero, or the corresponding parameters go to infinity, and then it behaves like this. So that's why the term degenerate integrable systems is very natural for those systems. But again, history is history, so we kind of have to accept this silly name superintegrability, which is completely confusing because there are integrable systems on supermanifolds and so on. So, okay. More examples. So there are so-called spin Kalogeri-Moser systems. They are obtained by the Hamiltonian reduction from the cotangent bundle on a group. And so the phase space is just a Hamiltonian reduction with respect to the coadjoint orbit O, and the Hamiltonian, so the Hamiltonians that have kind of remote physical meaning, they of this form. So without going into details, I want to state that these are superintegrable systems. So these Hamiltonians, they are given by G invariant functions on G star restricted to our orbit, to our symplectic manifold. So the balance of dimensions is that the symplectic leaf has dimension O, the intermediate Poisson manifold has dimension that is less by R, and the base has dimension R. So let me describe the quantum version of this system. And so before I'll do it, so symplectic leaves have dimension, the dimension of the orbit, and I keep forgetting to say generic symplectic leaves, minus twice the rank. Of course, our orbit O is even dimensional because it's a symplectic manifold. So the So the symplectic leaves are symplectic manifolds, so they should be even dimensional. So you can see clearly that this is an even number. So it's a good sign. So now the quantization of this system is the following. The Hilbert space is just the space of L2 functions on G with values in some irreducible finite dimensional. I'll be talking about finite dimensional irreducible representations. So this is a compact version of the Kolodziejczyk model system. So this G is compact, simple, etc. So the functions are invariant functions in this sense, and they are completely determined by the value on the Cartan subgroup, because in the compact case you can bring any element to the Cartan. And then because of the G invariance, because of the invariance with respect to the Cartan, actually this function should take the values in the zero weight subspace of this vector space of this representation V mu. So this is our Hilbert space. So you can think of this Hilbert space as the space of L2 functions on H with values in the zero weight subspace of V mu. So the Hamiltonian is minus the Laplacian on the Cartan subalgebra plus this potential. So here, these operators mu alpha, these are the generators of G acting on V mu. The Hilbert space decomposes with respect to the spectrum of Hamiltonians. So here, so these are the eigen subspaces of commuting Hamiltonians. And our Hamiltonian H is corresponds to this, to the second order Casimir, is just one of them. So this is the decomposition of the space. Here, the set of weights that appear in this decomposition is are the weights for which this space of G invariant maps is non-zero. So vectors in this Hilbert space, they can be realized as trace functions. So you just choose K from this space, choose a basis in this space, and then consider these functions. These are the eigenfunctions of H. So the dimension of this subspace is equal to the dimension of the space of G invariant maps here. And then it's a simple exercise to check that as H goes to zero, it behaves like this, where M is kind of a classical version of the multiplicity space. So this is just the space, multiplicity space for V mu in the tensor product V lambda tensor V lambda dual. So the classical analog of this multiplicity space is the Hamiltonian reduction of the product of three coadjoint orbits, one with the highest weight, that's a classical limit of lambda, the other is it's reflected, and the third one is the classical limit of mu. And I don't know, how much time do I have?
Oh, still at least 10, 15 minutes, depending on how much time you want to leave for questions.
Wonderful. Okay, so in what follow, this system is related to a torus with one puncture, where we assign the coadjoint orbit to this one puncture, the corresponding classical system. And I was talking about the quantum system just to kind of illustrate this dichotomy between the superintegrable systems and integrable systems in terms of the degree of degeneracy of the spectrum of quantum Hamiltonians. And just returning again to this system, so these subspaces, these are representations of certain algebra, and we know what kind of algebra acts there. It's this intermediate algebra J. It acts irreducibly on these spaces. Quantum J acts irreducibly on these spaces. So if you are in representation theory, it's a kind of interesting phenomenon, because in representation theory of G, nothing acts on invariant mappings from this tensor product to V mu. It's just a multiplicity space. But here, there is a whole algebra acting on this space. So it's there is an interesting representation theoretical aspects in these systems. So then there is a, so this is, I mean, if you ask physicists, do we care about such Hamiltonians? Real physicists probably say, maybe not. They don't look like anything resembling spin. But then there is so-called two-spin Kolodziej-Ramoser-Sutherland system. I think it was studied before by some people, but I didn't find the references. So I put this is for the pioneers whom I don't know the names, and this is my work from 2019. So so this is related to actually Lotze Fächer could be one of those people. So it's part of the investigation of this G mod K integrable systems, and this one is related to the symmetric space G cross G mod G mod G. So the phase space is just the product of PQ phase space and n copies of S2. But not quite. You have to take the level here. Ah, yes. So it's a subspace in this space. So this is the way how you fix the spins, classical spins. But then you also have to fix the total projection of the spin. So the Hamiltonian itself has this form. So now it's more physical. You really have the product of spins. This product of spheres appears from the following isomorphism. If you will take two orbits of rank one, so these are two orbits like this, where the rank one orbits where the second Casimir is fixed by number n. So you take the product of two orbits and do the Hamiltonian reduction with respect to the action of the Cartan. And then it turns out that this phase space is isomorphic to the product of n copies of SL2 quadjoint orbits with the weight, total weight n minus n prime. And then you have to just take a quotient with respect to H0. So this is actually the Hamiltonian reduction. Again, you can think of this as the Hamiltonian reduction with respect to the Cartan of, let's say, SU2. So again, there is a story about moduli spaces that relates it to the torus with two punctures. And the generalization to endpoint is in our paper with Jesper Stockmann, whom we almost finished last year, but you know, because of the fatigue of COVID, we didn't publish it. So hopefully it will, it will come out soon. Okay, so, but then there are relativistic versions of all this. So, and of Ruzinar's models, Ruzinar-Schneider models. So now let me explain the general umbrella sort of where all these systems are coming from. So the master symplectic manifolds then are moduli spaces of G-flat connections over a surface. So we fix an oriented compact surface with n boundary components. The moduli space is just the space of gauge classes of flat G connections on the principal trivial G bundle on sigma with respect to the gauge group, which is in this case is just mappings on sigma to G. So it's the it's just the so-called representation variety, or rather character variety. So it's the isomorphism classes of homomorphism from pi 1 of sigma to G mod G. It has a natural Poisson structure that goes back to RT and BOT. Symplectic leaves of this Poisson manifold are submanifolds where you fix the conjugacy class of the holonomy around each boundary component. So it's a finite dimensional singular symplectic manifolds. The Poisson structure can be nicely described in terms of so-called chord diagrams, which were first introduced by Bar-Natan in 1990, I think, when he wrote his thesis in the context of perturbation theory for Chern-Simons. It was published only in 95. So it's a certain algebra of chords on a surface. this is the extension of Goldman's results on the description of functions on moduli spaces of flat connections for surfaces, for classical groups. For any simple group, you can just describe it in a similar way, but it's not very important. What's important is that you have this so-called graph functions. And roughly speaking, these are the generalizations of Wilson loops, evaluations of Wilson loops on flat connections. And right from the work of Atiyah and Bott follows that these graph functions, they have the Poisson brackets like this. You take a graph function corresponding to the graph gamma 1, bracketed with graph function corresponding to graph gamma 2. These graphs' edges are colored by finite dimensional representations. Vertices are colored by G-invariant tensors in the tensor product of surrounding representations. And then you get the function that is the, you join gamma 1 and gamma 2 at the intersection point, and then you take the regular isotopy class of this graph and you take the sum over intersection points. And then the theorem is that it doesn't matter which geometric representatives of gamma, of this equivalence classes, gamma 1 and gamma 2 you choose, the bracket is independent of that. So in other words, that's a formula describing the Poisson structure on the moduli space. So corollary is the, you have this Poisson mapping from the Poisson algebra of chord diagrams to the Poisson algebra of functions on the moduli space. So now what it has to do with superintegrable systems. It turns out that you can construct superintegrable systems on these symplectic manifolds in the following way. Choose any collection non-intersecting, non-self-intersecting curves. It just, they don't have to be contractible to components of the boundary, otherwise the system will be trivial. Otherwise, they would, this would be Casimirs with prescribed values. So here's an example. Here's the surface with two boundary components and with two cycles on them. So we can consider the following Poisson subalgebras. This is the subalgebra where the basis is given by graph functions for graphs that are contractible to these cycles C1, CK. So this is the Poisson subalgebra in the whole algebra of functions generated, I mean, spanned by graph functions for graphs that do not intersect these contours C1, CK. And then there is a nice theorem. Sorry for saying nice, it's really nice, but I'm a co-author of this theory. So which says that this subalgebra of graph functions, so contractible means the following, that if this is our cycle, then you can sort of put any graph that's kind of, that can be constrained in some kind of band, and then you can move this band and shrink it over to CI. So it turns out that this I is the Poisson center of J, and so the dimensions, they match, and the functions that are contractible to contours, they define a superintegrable system. Moreover, it's possible to construct angle variables explicitly in this case. So the systems can really be explicitly integrated in the same way as Kalogeri-Moser systems, Sutherland systems can be integrated, and Ruzynars for the same reasons. So that's good. And then say an example of this system where you have N punctures was studied recently by Chalich and Feyron, the kind of the flattened version of this. And if N equals one, that's the spin Kalogeri-Moser system that I was talking about. N equals two, this is the two spin. When the corresponding orbits, it's a relativistic version. And here it's also a relativistic version. So here you have to fix just one conjugacy class for one puncture. And here you have to fix two conjugacy classes for two punctures. And in general, they are superintegrables, but when rank of C1 and rank of C2 are one, then they are Liouville integrable. It's actually, it's another story. So yes, and then there is a story about quantization of these systems, but I don't know, am I running out of time?
Probably, yes. If we want to leave a couple minutes for questions, I think.
Okay, I'll save the story for the next time, the quantum story. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful, thank you. Does anyone have any questions?
So, can you hear me? Can I speak? Yeah, okay. So in your very first definition of superintegrable system, so if you put your K is bigger than N, what will happen?
No, k is always strictly less than m. Okay. You cannot have Poisson commutative subalgebra with k greater than m.
Okay. Yeah, my second question is your classical picture of the Kepler system. So do you have a physical intuition of your E? When E is less than zero, so you have a stable system. When E is bigger than zero, you have the... So what's the corresponding picture of our planetary motion?
If I understand correctly, the question is, what is the difference between E less than zero and E greater than zero?
Yes.
The difference is that if E is less than zero, then all Liouville tori are compact.
Yeah.
And if E is greater than zero, they are non-compact. So it's, in physics, yes, it sort of means that there is a stability for E less than zero and the system is unstable for E greater than zero.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. So there is one question in chat. Ah, that's not the question, it's a comment. About 5 minutes.
We have any other questions? If not, I had a question about, I think you made a mention a while back in the very beginning, talking about sort of the quantum version of the rank of this JK,
mm-hmm.
right? And this is something that we've thought about a lot. Do you have a well-defined, or do you have an idea of what would be sort of the version of algebraic independence in the quantum version for your that subalgebra?
That's a super good question. Just a super integrability. This is a super good question. Intuitively, it's clear what it means. It's locally, if you're quantizing symplectic manifold, locally, it's just the algebra of differential operators. So in some sense, I should say that I don't really have a good notion of the rank in the non-commutative version, except something like this. Say, you know, any quantization has its formal counterpart. So even if you have the real algebraic quantization, say in terms of difference operators or anything like this, it has a formal neighborhood of zero, and so it has this formal deformation part. So I would call the rank of the non-commutative algebra of this kind just the dimension of the corresponding Poisson algebra. Assuming that you have torsion-free deformation quantization. So for me, sort of, I mentally define it usually as the following. A family of non-associative algebras has rank n if it's a torsion-free deformation of a Poisson algebra of rank n. But I don't have a good algebraic definition. Do you have a good one?
Yeah. No, not at all. But I like yours. It's an interesting one to think about. And
okay. Yes, it's a question. Over.
Yeah. I
have a question.
Yes.
Why it is one-dimensional in the Kepler problem? Why the Hamiltonian is center is one-dimensional? What about the third component of the momentum, one component of momentum, commute with Hamiltonian commute with itself. And so it's two-dimensional.
Well, dear friend, I think we know each other for almost 40 years. So let me tell you that, as always, you didn't pay attention to this.
Yes.
So the thing is that this and actually, sorry, I didn't say this. So it's not your fault, it's my fault. So Kepler problem naively can be considered as a Liouville problem, integrable system. So there is a Hamiltonian H, and you're absolutely right, there is MZ. So there are two integrals, the Z projection of the momentum and the Hamiltonian. So that's a Liouville integrable system. But then there is this Hamiltonian, and it's the central subalgebra in our algebra J5 and so on. So this is an example of a refinement. You have Liouville integrable system with two Hamiltonians. A priori, you cannot really say whether trajectories are one-dimensional or they kind of span these two-dimensional Liouville torus. But with this refinement, you know that all trajectories are periodic. That's the meaning of the superintegrable refinement.
So I need extra dimensions. So if I have only two dimensions, so I don't have superintegrable system. Or I do.
I wouldn't call it dimensions. I would say.
No. I want to study the motion in the play. Only two coordinates, two momenta. I forget about the third dimension. I mean the space. I have Hamiltonian and angular momentum, and I know that the trajectory of periodic without all your extra stuff.
Sorry, you want to study the motion on a plane?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's the same because the planets move in the plane. We can forget about extra dimension. Once we know the plane, so we don't need all that.
You know, I didn't think about it, but I assume that it's the same.
Okay. You need to say something more about this, I don't know, two integrals. Because you know that the periodic, the trajectories are periodic.
So it should be the same. It should be the same in two dimensions. You have T star R2. So the phase space is four dimensional. You have the Hamiltonian. So you should expect the following. The reason why the trajectories are periodic is that you have conserved quantities. And presumably these are just the Hamiltonian, the generator of the rotation in two dimensions, and maybe some kind of analog of the lens.
No, you do have Lens vector. Yes, you have Lens vector.
Then that's it. So then again, you have this intermediate Poisson algebra J3. And in quantum case, that's the algebra that acts on your multiplicity spaces for the spectrum. I didn't think about two dimensions because the beauty of the Kepler system and the hydrogen atom, that these are actually three-dimensional systems that we care about.
Okay. Yeah, but Newton did everything in the plane.
Before Newton, there was this uncle of Euler who did everything. So, but in different terms.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you for the question, actually. It's a nice remark.
Okay, well, I think if there's no more questions, we'll thank the speaker again, and thank you all for joining.
Well, thank you for coming, for listening, for questions. Sarah, you will put me on the list.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, please. Okay. Yes.
Thank you. Okay, bye.
Bye, thank you.
Bye. See you in 2 weeks.
See you.